It's got to be appropriate and effective. You have to have certain conditions. So it's a well-established system of democratic institutions, adequate civil and political rights protection, including, of course, universal suffrage. Some places have compulsory voting without universal suffrage, believe it or not. The apparatus of constitutionalism, limits on political power, free, competitive and fair elections. And from an administrative point of view, you have to have a developed national infrastructure so you can run the elections properly and with integrity. Reasonable levels of cooperation between regional and central governments, particularly within a federal structure, and professional, well-funded, independent and accountable electoral commissions. And there's a few other things you need that I'll talk about as I go along. But when any of those conditions fail to be met, the effectiveness and or legitimacy of the compulsory voting system will be in question. Now, the UK is fine with that, but the most important thing is to have the system to perceive to be legitimate. A legitimate burden on your freedom. What's the point of making people do it if it's got all these, it's done in an illegitimate context? So how do we overcome public resistance? How do we get and maintain public approval while achieving compliance? And what can Australia teach us here? We look to Australia because over many decades, Australia's had very high approval levels for compulsory voting, 70% plus, sometimes up to 77, 80%. And this happens every time we have an election. Australians are consistently happy with compulsory voting. Well, I think, why do Australians accept their system? The first reason, I think, is that Australians do tend to accept voting as a duty. When Australians are asked what is the most important mark of a good citizen, the first thing they say is voting. The second thing they say is obeying the law. They have quite a reverence for the law because they appointed the legislators. So they feel implicated in those laws and bound by them. And the third thing is not evading taxation. So they have a strong sense of political community. So Australians do have, I think, about the highest sense in the world of a sense of civic duty, believe it or not. I think this is partly reinforced by compulsory voting. So that's something you need. And so again, it's promising in the UK that people do have this attitude towards voting. I've known from the past, from other research, that people in the UK do have quite a strong sense of duty about voting in the way that, say, Americans might not. They'll see it more as a negative right. So what is the take-home message there? There's not a lot we can do except to build on that sense of duty, but in promoting compulsory voting to first-time voters, you would promote it in your advertising campaigns, I suppose, as a duty rather than voting as a duty rather than a right. The second way of improving public tolerance is to seek to minimise transaction and opportunity costs to voters, and this is something that the Australian state has done extremely well. And so in voting in Australia is actually, as we all know, anyone who votes here anyway, is actually an extremely painless affair. It's so easy. You sort of say, so how did I get enrolled? Did I enrol myself? Did they send me a letter and I just fill it in? You don't even remember the trouble it took you to get enrolled because it was made so easy. And then you turn up at the school, which is just around the corner, on your way to the shops. There aren't long queues. No one's ever running out of ballot papers. There's plenty of people there to assist you. It's very costless. So you want to minimise all transaction and opportunity costs to voters. And I think it would be hard to find a system with such low opportunity and transaction costs as the Australian system. Electoral commissions go to considerable lengths to accommodate ageing and immobile people, the homeless, those living in remote regions, prisoners, people with disabilities, people who are ill, infirm, housebound, living abroad, approaching maternity, hospitalised, have literacy and numeracy problems, vision impaired or hearing impaired, are from a non-English speaking background. There are also special provisions for silent enrolment if you don't want to be on the roll, if you think it's dangerous to be on the roll. Itinerant enrolment if you're homeless, and we've always had homeless people voting. In many settings, homeless people can't vote, and it's only quite recently that homeless people in Britain could vote. If you travel constantly or if you have no permanent address. In Australia, you can put your address as doorstop on Elizabeth Street next to such and such building. You can actually put something that ambiguous, usually where I lay down my sleeping bag. At election time, up to 500 mobile teams will visit 2,000 special hospital locations. They'll visit 300 outback locations, over 100 overseas polling booths, where 3 tonnes of election material will be shipped beforehand, even to the Antarctic and Antarctic supply ships. Now, I'm not saying there are no exclusions in the Australian system. There are. There are some residual exclusions, and they're not all trivial. But they're not on the scale of exclusions elsewhere, and the electoral commissions take them very seriously and work like hell to try and overcome them wherever they can within the law as laid down by legislators. It's not always easy. So no one here, no matter how immobilised, isolated or marginalised you are, is expected to meet the potentially high end transaction and opportunity costs of voting. And this, no doubt, has helped keep ensure compliance on the one hand and kept antipathy towards the institution at bay. Take home message, make voting as easy as possible for electors. Three, you need to take great care about the way that compulsory voting laws are framed. You need to be very careful about what you're saying is compulsory here. Because you're compelling people to do something, you better be careful that you're not telling them what to think. This would mean, in my opinion, just telling them that it's only registration and attendance at a polling place that's required, not actual formal marking of the ballot paper. Because some people might think, and quite rightly, that none of the candidates are worth voting for. And so I think we should let people think that. We could have a system similar to that which existed in the Netherlands, which could be instituted, whereby the law stipulates that it's only attendance at a polling place that's required. So that was actually in the law. And that practice of obligatory attendance, and I can never say, ah, Sarah last night, did you know how to pronounce it? Any Dutch people here? It's opkomstplicht. It's spelled O-P-K-O-M-S-T-P-L-I-C-T. It's hard to believe there's even such a word. But they did it, and it was a very good idea. Making that clear that it's just attendance and registration that's mandatory would forestall the common objection that mandatory voting either limits democratic choice, forces voters to lie, to say, oh, I like these people, when you don't like any of them, or operates as a mechanism to manufacture consent. Optional preferential in a preferential system is always another way around this issue of forcing people to lie, because there's a point at which we all in the last election decided we don't like, I've stopped liking anyone here and I wish to stop numbering my ballot, but we weren't allowed to. That's another thing you could do. But you don't want to give the impression that you're forcing people to lie or making this look like a mechanism to manufacture consent. Having that mechanism would also protect the institution from attack should it ever be tested against a Bill of Rights, which Australia lacks, but Britain does not. The United Kingdom has a statutory Bill of Rights. I'm not really scared of that Bill of Rights because it's just statutory. But British citizens can apply to the European Court of Human Rights. And that court does hear suffrage cases and has actually heard a case about compulsory voting from an Austrian man who reckoned that compulsory voting violated a whole bunch of his civil and political rights. But the court found that there was none of his rights were violated, provided there was no requirement to mark the ballot. So you would want to have that mechanism in place to protect the compulsory voting from legal challenge, because if a court decided that it was unconstitutional, it was a violation of somebody's rights, over and out. So my reasons are partly strategic and they're partly moral. Now, I don't endorse compelling people to mark the ballot also because I feel it's too coercive. Now, this might sound odd and perhaps a bit arbitrary coming from someone that goes on and on and on about compulsory voting and how great it is. But I believe voters should retain the right to mark the ballot as they see fit. After all, the point of elections is to find out what voters really think. And if they really think that none of the candidates are worth voting for, parties and candidates ought to get that message. Further, it is an arbitrary because A, requiring attendance usually gets the job done anyway. So what happens is that when you require people to vote, they do come along that most of them, the vast majority, do end up using their vote in a formal manner. B, for the practical reason that asking for more than attendance from voters would bring the institution of compulsory voting into disrepute. And C, in any case, any self-respecting democracy has a secret ballot, and so enforcing compulsory voting would be impossible, and if you try to enforce it, that's not very nice. You don't want to violate the secret ballot. Personally, I think in most cases it's better to formally mark the ballot, but there are some people that it's not better for them to do that. The fourth thing you can do enhance public tolerance of compulsory voting is to take great care about this, how the compulsory voting laws are enforced. So you're careful about framing them, then be very careful about the way you enforce them. Now we know from the empirical data that if you don't have legal sanctions for compulsory voting that are consistently applied, you won't get compliance. People will just ignore them. So you have to have sanctions, you can't get out of that. And they have to be enforced consistently, but the important thing is without zealotry. You can't have the state going berserk and jailing everyone and making a big fuss about it. And I think the Australian state makes a very nice model here. Because Australians In Australia, compliance is high with the law, so 95% of registered voters every election turn out to vote, and approval is very high, and Australians don't kick up about the fine. The penalty for failure to attend is just a $20 fine, and most cases of recalcitrance are dealt with by please explain letters, and that's an honest system. If you just write up a letter saying, oh, I feel a bit sick in my tummy, I actually did one year to see if it would work. But it was a council election in Sydney. And so I didn't care about that. I'd never do that for my state or federal election. I would never waste my vote in that way. But I just wanted to see. It's like, I just felt a bit sick. I really was sick. It worked. So it's an honour system that you don't have to provide any proof that happened. And prosecutions are very rare. Less than 1% of the Australian electorate is faced with a fine or court attendance in any given election period. And it's worth noting here that voting is so easy that the failure to vote is actually more trouble than voting. It's much easier just to stop in and vote than to write your letter. So this is the secret of success. And it sounds easy, but of course the amount of work that has gone into making voting easy is pretty intense. But it works beautifully. So take-home message for Britain would be there needs to be sanctions which are mild but consistently applied and without zealotry. And also make abstention a bit more trouble than actually voting. 5, what else do you need for a successful compulsory voting regime? You need high levels of perceived legitimacy of electoral processes and outcomes. I don't foresee any problem there with the UK since they invented the Westminster style of election, so I think they'll be able to get that right. And then I've got a section here on how Australia has managed to do that very well. Our elections are generally free from corruption and rigging scandals. Election officers are organised, integrated despite federalism, professional, well-funded, independent, accountable and apolitical. And they go to a lot of trouble to make sure they're apolitical. I've seen them in action. It's quite aggravating at times. But they're exempt from the laws that make it illegal to ask anybody what their legal affiliation is. I've seen them do that too in an interview. And I was very shocked. And I said to them afterwards, why? You can't ask that question. So we're exempt from that legislation. They're very scrupulous. Now, I know you're all sitting there thinking about what about that 1,375 votes that went missing, that were lost in the WA election? That's pretty egregious. That is outrageous. It's egregious. But that's being allowed to overshadow the fact that millions upon millions upon millions of Australians' votes have been successfully cast and safely delivered and totally legally protected by electoral commissions. And so this is rare, and everybody in the electoral studies sort of community is very shocked by that, because knowing how the electoral commissions work, that sort of thing just doesn't happen. I can't imagine how that breakdown occurred.
Just say, Lisa, the number of seats in which 1,375 votes decides the result are quite small, so it usually won't have a lower house seat generally wouldn't matter.
I know, but it's the idea of it. Every vote is sacred, and that's been the attitude of the commissions, and one vote lost is a crime against the people. So our elections are remarkably free from interference and corruption. Say, for example, between 1998 and 2007, not a single Australian was prosecuted for multiple voting. This doesn't mean not a single person was investigated. Hundreds and thousands were. The electoral commissions and the federal police investigate everything that looks a bit dodgy, and no one's ever prosecuted, because in every single case they found out that it was an elderly person that had cast a vote in their retirement home, and then the kids had come the next day and take them out to vote, and they'd forgotten or didn't want to be impolite and say, I already voted, so he did it again. So it's usually something like that.